These are satellite images from the deserts of western China. Look closely and you'll see these huge complexes being built. From the sky, they sort of look like factories or even schools. But look even closer. This line is one facility's perimeter wall. And these shadows, they're cast by watchtowers along the wall. This compound isn't a school or a factory. It's an internment camp. Inside these camps, the Chinese government is detaining as many as 1 million Uyghurs, China's mostly Muslim minority. China doesn't want the world to know any of this. But the story of these camps is also the story of how we know about them, and China's efforts to cover them up.
As soon as we began to document the re-education centers, there was Chinese government officials deleting what we were finding.
Uyghurs mainly live here, in the Xinjiang province of northwestern China. That puts them closer to the capitals of Kyrgyzstan and Uzbekistan than to Beijing. And Uyghurs are also closer culturally to those Turkic groups than they are to the Han Chinese, China's ethnic majority.
The Uyghurs speak a Turkic language. Their culture is different. They have particular styles of music, a whole rich history that is unique to them.
This is Seagal Samuel, a reporter at Vox.
I've been reporting on the Uyghur crisis in China for about a year now. China has been concerned for decades about the possibility of Uyghur separatism.
Uyghurs have actually had their own independent nation two separate times in the last century. In 1933, they established the Islamic Republic of East Turkestan, here in Kashgar. But it crumbled less than a year later when it was taken over by Chinese forces. Then, in 1944, the Soviet Union backed the creation of the East Turkestan Republic, based here. But when China became communist in 1949, the Soviet Union turned on East Turkestan and helped China take it over again. Part of why the Xinjiang region is so important to China is that it's rich with energy resources. And as China's economy grew, so did its need for energy. Today, Xinjiang accounts for nearly 40% of China's coal reserves and over 20% of the country's oil and gas. It also accounts for 20% of China's potential for wind energy.
China needs resources, it needs energy, it needs the geographical location, the area on which Xinjiang sits. That's where Uyghurs are, that's where they're living. And so China really wants to have a solid sense of control over that area.
As far back as the 1950s, China saw an opportunity to dilute the influence of the potentially rebellious Uyghurs and started encouraging the migration of Han Chinese into Xinjiang. And it worked. In 1945, Uyghurs made up over 80% of the population, compared to just 6% Han Chinese. By 2008, Xinjiang was 46% Uyghur, compared to 39% Han Chinese. But over the years, as Xinjiang developed economically, Uyghurs were left behind, working mostly low-wage jobs in agriculture, while the Han held higher-paying jobs. Finally, in 2009, a Uyghur protest against discrimination at the hands of the Han and the Chinese government erupted in violence.
Bloody riots broke out, pitting ethnic Uyghur Muslims against the dominant Han Chinese.
One of the worst riots took place in the provincial capital of Urumqi. About 200 people were killed and hundreds injured during the unrest.
That was sort of an inflection point. After that, the Chinese really started to crack down harder on the Uyghurs.
And by 2013, Xinjiang had become even more important to China. The country launched the Belt and Road Initiative, a trillion-dollar investment in things like fiber optic cables, train lines, and gas pipelines, meant to boost the country's economic and political influence around the world by making it easier to trade with China. If you plot these projects on a map, you'll see a lot of them pass through Xinjiang, making the province arguably the most important corridor for the whole project. China would need to ensure that Xinjiang remained securely in its hands.
The Uyghurs came to be perceived and painted more as a threat, as a separatist threat, as an extremist threat.
In 2016 and 2017, the country enacted a series of de-extremification policies aimed at Muslims, like banning long beards. And Xinjiang was effectively turned into a high-tech police state.
So this kind of thing is happening all over the country, but in Xinjiang, it's been just increased by orders of magnitude. We're talking about Uyghurs having to hand over their phones at checkpoints. We're even talking about QR codes being installed on the outside of their homes.
But the most brutal part of this crackdown was hidden to the world at first.
In this image, you see the opening of this facility. The signage, it says De-extremification Re-education Center.
Around 2017, China started building these internment camps, these large-scale places to detain Uyghurs. China says that these camps are necessary because the Uyghurs are a terrorist threat, a separatist threat, people who are infected with extremist thinking.
But it wasn't until Uyghurs who had been detained told their stories that the picture from inside the camps came into clearer focus.
They're forced to memorize and recite Communist Party propaganda every day. They're often forced to criticize their own Islamic beliefs and to criticize the beliefs of their fellow detainees.
We had to sing songs hailing the Communist Party. We had to repeat in Chinese, "Long live Xi Jinping."
There have been reports of death, of torture.
Three guards surrounded me and abused me.
Each time I was electrocuted, my whole body would shake.
So there's this atmosphere of just trying to uproot what you believe in.
At first, China denied the existence of these camps. But activists and academics fought back.
A lot of people around the world are scouring the internet for evidence of China's internment camps for Uyghurs.
In terms of the strategies and tools that I've used, I know others have used to uncover evidence of these camps, it's quite simply a computer and knowledge of Chinese and thinking about what words, especially government websites, would use.
People have unearthed government documents.
And then we had growing visual evidence. We're looking at satellite images. We can actually trace the creation and expansion of the re-education camp. It was a matter of I think luck or chance that I uncovered this image. And until then, we didn't have that piece of visual evidence that said, this is what it is, and this is what the Chinese government is calling it.
Tim isn't alone. There's a whole network of web sleuths around the world using basic internet tools to document what China doesn't want the world to see. And they've gotten China to change their story, at least a little.
China was denying that these re-education centers exist until journalists and academics and others started to really amass a body of evidence that was so convincing that China couldn't just deny it anymore.
China took a different approach and started admitting that these facilities exist, but carefully painted them as training schools for potential criminals or terrorists. In the meantime, the camps are still there and growing. This camp, one of China's largest, was as big as the nearby city of Dabancheng in 2017. But by 2018, the camp had expanded to twice the size.
From China's perspective, they think it's worth it. They want to make sure Xinjiang is an area of the country that they have total control over. And if that comes with a high human cost and even a reputational blow on the international stage, China so far seems willing to do that anyway.